We had been in the middle of a message series titled Christmas Challenges. The first week we looked at the story of Zechariah and Elizabeth, which were the parents of John the Baptist and Jesus' aunt and uncle. We talked about overcoming doubt. Last week we talked about when Mary and Joseph found out that Mary was pregnant while she was still a virgin. And we talked about the crisis that that brought about and moving from crisis to celebration. And today we're going to talk about the subject of rejection. Now, before I get into our sermon for today, I want to remind you of a couple of things. One, I want to let you know that we will be collecting our Christmas missions offering at the end of our service. That's a special second offering we take in the month of December, which is to support missionaries and God's mission work all around the world. I want to encourage you to give to it. We ask everyone to give the equivalent of what you would give to a family member as a gift for Christmas to support God's work all around the world. The other thing that I want to remind you is that we will not be having any Wednesday night midweek collaborate classes for the next 3 weeks for the Christmas holiday, so we won't be having those coming up. Wanted to make sure you knew that. That being said, let's get into our sermon for today. I'll read Luke chapter 2 in just 1 minute. And today we're going to be talking about the subject of rejection. Now, rejection is one of the worst feelings a person can have in all the world. But the truth is that most of us have experienced it in some way, shape, or form. I kind of count myself to be an expert on rejection. I remember when I was in the 9th grade, I was hooked up with this girl through some mutual friends, and we began talking on the phone. How many of you remember having a house phone? You remember that? Some of you remember a cordless phone. Some of you remember the one in the kitchen with the real long cord on it. Some of you remember where you had to dial somebody's phone number, and you get mad if it had a lot of nines in it because it would hurt your finger. And if you messed up, you had to start all the way over. And some of you, you remember calling into the operator who had to switch you on to somebody else. And some of you, you had to send a telegraph. You know what I'm talking about, right? So we all remember those kind of days and time. I remember I was talking to this girl on the phone for like a month and a half. We were talking every night. Man, we were connecting. Boy, we were hitting it off. And then I met her in person, and she looked at me and she said, "Well, you're not attractive at all." And that was the end of that relationship right there. And I just remember feeling so rejected. Don't you feel bad for your pastor? But it's okay, because I like good wine. I get better with age. You know what I'm saying? So I've experienced rejection, so have you. We've all experienced rejection. Sometimes it's by family, sometimes it's by friends, sometimes by people we work with. And the story of Joseph and Mary is no different. They experienced some significant rejection in their life. And we talk about this during the holiday seasons, because even though Christmas is supposed to be a time of great joy and great celebration and great happiness, the reality is for a lot of people, it stirs up a lot of difficult and challenging emotions. And one of those emotions is rejection. In Luke chapter 2, we see the story of Joseph and Mary. This is after they found out Mary was pregnant. Joseph decided to stay committed to her. It says, at that time, the Roman Emperor Augustus decreed that a census should be taken throughout the Roman Empire. This was the first census taken when Quirinius was the governor of Syria. All returned to their own ancestral towns to register for the census. Because Joseph was a descendant of King David, he had to go to Bethlehem in Judea, David's ancient home. He traveled there from the village of Nazareth in Galilee. He took with him Mary, his fiancée, who was now obviously pregnant. Let's say that phrase, obviously pregnant, together on three. One, two, three. Now, how far along was Mary in her pregnancy? Obviously 10 months, right? Because you never ask a woman if she's pregnant unless you see the baby being born. And even then, you double check before you ask, okay? Verse 6, while they were there, the time came for her baby to be born. She gave birth to her first child, a son. She wrapped him snugly in strips of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no lodging available for them. So this passage tells us that Mary was pregnant with the Messiah, the Savior of the world, and she, along with Joseph, had to travel back to Joseph's family hometown of Bethlehem in order to sign up and register for a census, and that there was no room for them. Now, many of you are familiar with the phrase, there was no room in the inn. How many of you are familiar with that idea? And this is a little bit confusing and misleading for people. Let me break it down for you to help you understand this and why this is so important. To understand, the town where Jesus was from, Joseph and Mary were from, Nazareth, had about 200 to 400 people that lived in it at the time Jesus was born, when Mary was pregnant. They went to Bethlehem, which was only a town of about 1,000 people. There were not a lot of people living there. It's not really hard to figure out that in Bethlehem there would be no Crown Plazas like this. There were no Holiday Inns. There were no Sheratons or Marriotts or Hiltons. There wasn't even a Hilton Garden Inn or a Residence Inn. There wasn't even a Motel 6 where somebody left a light on for you. As a matter of fact, there wasn't even a Roach Motel. The truth is, the idea inn is a little bit misleading because you get this picture that there's some hotel with an innkeeper saying, no, there's no vacancy, you can't stay here. The Greek word that's used when this passage is written is the word kataluma, and usually it's referencing a guest room in a person's house. For a Jew in that day, if you were to travel somewhere, you wouldn't stay in a hotel. You would do it old school. Some of you remember this. When you went on a vacation when you were a kid, what did that mean? You went and stayed with family who lived somewhere else, right? So if you had family in Waggaman, that's where you were going on vacation, right? Pack it up. We going to Waggaman. You know, we going real exotic, Lacombe, right? We got family out there. That's who we going to stay with. In the same way, you would go stay with family. And the way that they would live is that downstairs, it'd be the place where they would live, and they would have a separate section, which would be a stable, where they would keep all their animals, which were their prized possessions, to make sure they weren't stolen. And then on their roof, they would build a guest room, and whenever family would come over or friends would come to stay, that's where they would stay, would be in the guest room. And to understand the rejection that Joseph and Mary were facing, it wasn't just some innkeeper who said there was no room for you. Literally, this was Joseph's hometown where all his people were from. And he went to where his people were from, and they said, sorry, we don't have any room for you, but we'll let you stay in the stable with the animals. That's the only place we got for you. Now you imagine that's the way your family puts you, right? Literally, you can stay in the doghouse. You can stay in the pig pen. You can stay with all the animals. Now I'm not the smartest man in the world, but I can't imagine the perfect environment for a baby to be born being in a stable. I mean, some people have their babies in hospitals. Some people do the home births. I know that's a thing people do. Some people do the water birth where you have the baby in water. I don't know how that works, but apparently that's a thing. But I can promise you, having a baby in the stable is not an ideal situation. Amen? I mean, what's it smell like in the stable? You ever been to a parade? What happened when the horse comes by, right? And the little pooper scooper comes out. How's it smelling? How's the hay smell? I mean, you can't even tell if the baby used the bathroom or not because it just smells like that all the time, right? Did you check his diaper? I don't know. It just smells like that all the time in here. That's how it was in this environment. Now, you got to remember, this is Joseph's family, right? So imagine how Mary's feeling. Those of you who are married, you know it's a problem when the husband's family rejects the wife, right? That's an issue, right? Okay, y'all not saying that because you brought your in-laws to hear the kids sing. I already know that, right? But that's the issue, right? So here's Mary. We traveled all this way. I'm obviously pregnant. And they got us staying out here with the sheep and the donkeys and the goats. And then it says when the baby was born, they put the baby in a manger. And that word manger just sounds so romantic, and we get these pictures of it was moonlight, and it was all nice, and it was nice little padded area, and it looked like a little crib that they made for the baby. You know what a manger is? A feeding trough. It's what the horses ate out of, and where the sheep ate out of, and the pigs ate out of. It wasn't nothing but a feeding trough. They were just putting the baby wherever they could. Hey, he won't roll out of that. From the very first start of their life, Mary and Joseph were experiencing rejection from their family. Now, why were they experiencing rejection? Well, I mean, imagine it. They show up for Joseph's family. Here he's got his fiance. They're not married, and she's knocked up. Right? Well, that's not how you did things in those days. That's not how you functioned. That's not how you operated. And the family was probably thinking, well, we don't want y'all just staying in our house. I mean, we don't know what you're going to do to the area, to the environment, to the atmosphere. You can't stay here, but we'll let you stay with the dogs. Here's the reality. Joseph and Mary experienced great rejection from their family. Jesus experienced great rejection even as a child. And in the same way, every one of us here has experienced rejection from time to time. In the same way that God wanted Joseph and Mary to be able to overcome the rejection they experienced, he wants you and I today to overcome the experience of rejection that we might face from time to time. So today we want to look at what does it take to move from rejection to redemption, which is what God does for everyone, no matter what rejection we've experienced. If you're filling in blank, taking notes, moving from rejection to redemption requires, number one, here's your first fill in the blank, leaving our comfort zones. Leaving our comfort zones. In Luke 2, 3 through 4, it says, all returned to their own ancestral towns to register for this census, and because Joseph was a descendant of King David, he had to go to Bethlehem in Judea, David's ancient home. They traveled there from the village of Nazareth in Galilee. Now I want you to understand that God was having them leave their own home, leave their own place of comfort to go somewhere on a journey that was not going to be comfortable, but they had to step out in order to fulfill what God was calling them to do in their lives. Now the journey from Nazareth to Bethlehem is roughly 65 miles. Now how long does it take you to get 65 miles? Some people an hour, some people 45 minutes, some people 30 minutes if you're on I-55, right? It depends on where you're going and who you're with, but really that's not much of a journey. Well, in their day, that was a 4 to 5 day journey because there were no roads. I mean, we think the roads are jacked up here in New Orleans, but you don't really know what jacked up roads are until you go into third world countries or other parts of the world. And if you go 2,000 years ago, there were no roads at all. And this is a very rugged terrain, and Mary's there on a donkey trying to ride through all this. And imagine where she's at in her life. She's pregnant. How pregnant? Obviously pregnant. And she's on a donkey, leaving her comfortable environment, traveling with her husband in order to go where they need to go. You know, here's the reality. The Lord will often lead us to do things that are uncomfortable, out of what is comfort. And here's the problem. Most people only want to serve God if it's going to be comfortable. And we think, well, God's only going to ask me to do something that's comfortable. But here's the truth. God usually calls us out of what's comfortable, into what's uncertain, into what's uncomfortable, because it's during those times that he really can work in and through us. See, there was more happening here than just a census. God was setting things up. God was working behind the scenes, and he was working ahead of schedule. And just like he did that in Joseph and Mary's life, he does the same in our own lives. He's working behind the scenes. We don't see what God's doing. We don't understand what God's setting up, but God's also working ahead of schedule. He knows what's coming. He knows what the future holds, and God was setting all this up. How do we know this? Well, the prophet Micah, 400 years earlier in Micah 5:2, shared a prophecy about the coming Messiah. It says, but you, O Bethlehem, Ephrath, you're only a small village among the people of Judah, yet a ruler of Israel, whose origins are in the distant past, will come from you on my behalf. God had planned and set up hundreds of years before this moment happened that the Messiah, the Son of God, the Savior of the world, Jesus Christ, would be born in the town of Bethlehem. And if you can imagine, his parents were from Nazareth, but God set all of this up and worked all of this out so at the right time, at the right moment, Jesus would be born right where he needed to be born. The only way Joseph and Mary could fulfill this plan that God had would be for them to be willing to step out of what was comfortable. And we all have to decide that in our lives. Are we willing to step out of what's comfortable in order to allow God to redeem what we have going on? Here's the second thing we learn. To move from rejection to redemption, it also requires us enduring our discomfort. We also have to be willing to allow our lives to be uncomfortable from time to time. In verse 5, it says that Mary went with Joseph while she was obviously pregnant. You think about this. Mary was told to mount up on a donkey at almost full-term pregnancy and ride all the way to Bethlehem over hills and rocks along dirt roads, bouncing back and forth, all while enduring the pain. My wife's been pregnant 4 times. I've seen her regular pregnant, I've seen her barely pregnant, and I've seen her obviously pregnant. When you get to obviously pregnant, what is uncomfortable? Everything, right? Sleeping's uncomfortable, sitting's uncomfortable, breathing is uncomfortable, eating's uncomfortable, just thinking is uncomfortable when you're obviously pregnant. Ladies, can I get an amen? Amen. See, here's the reality. This was in an uncomfortable journey. Imagine being obviously pregnant, riding on a donkey over a mountain, through the cliffs on the side of the valley to go to your husband's family's house. This was not a pleasant experience. This was not set up the way God, and you know Joseph got lost, right? And Mary's like, we already been past this mountain. You need to ask for help. He's not asking for help. It's just making it worse. And it wasn't just uncomfortable for her. It was uncomfortable for him, because when a woman's uncomfortable and a woman's got a problem, what's the man try to do? Fix it. And what's the woman don't want him to do? Fix it. But he keeps trying to fix it. Well, you know, if you just sit like this, it wouldn't hurt so much. Well, if you try laying this way, have you done this? And they fighting and they bickering and they arguing on this five-day journey for 5 days. She's pregnant, uncomfortable, this miserable, and God, this is his plan. I need you to make this journey. Sometimes God calls us to a place in life where we will endure the discomfort. When I read this story, I just think, why didn't Mary just stay home? Let him go. And I think maybe Mary's like my wife. You know, sometimes I go to drop my wife off at the front of the restaurant. I'm like, hey, baby, I'll drop you off in the front. She says, no. I just want to be with you. Y'all wives don't say that? Maybe I'm a good husband. Your wife don't want to be with you. I don't know. She's like, I'd rather be with you. And imagine she's pregnant. She's discouraged. Women don't like the way they look when they're pregnant. She don't want him off. They're not even married yet. It's still his fiance. She said, no, I'm just going to stick with you. I'll go with you. I'll be with you. And they ride through all this discomfort, and then they get to his family's house, and what do they say? You ain't staying with us. The reality is there was some discomfort that was going on, but there was great reward for the discomfort. This is what we got to understand. Sometimes God puts us in a situation that's uncomfortable so that we can grow through it. God works in us when we're uncomfortable. It's only when we're uncomfortable that we start relying on God. We start trusting in God. We start leaning on God. We start depending on God. When everything's comfortable, we don't need God. We don't look to God. God, I got it. I don't need your help. I don't need your answers. I don't need your involvement. I got this. When we get uncomfortable, all of a sudden we start leaning on God. C.S. Lewis says this, hardships often prepare ordinary people for an extraordinary destiny. This is what I'll tell you. People who are married that go through hard times together and endure have the strongest marriages in the world. Because then when they come to up against anything, they say, this ain't nothing. We already been through way worse than this. Oh, we got this. We can solve this problem. This ain't nothing. Endurance is what builds character and what builds strength and what makes strong people, and it's no different when it comes to the things of faith. The people that have gone through things in their life and have endured them, gone through hardships and allowed God to develop them, those are the people who are the strongest. You know, when I look back on every hard time in my life, I realize if it wasn't for those hard times, I wouldn't be the Christian I am, I wouldn't be the pastor I am, I wouldn't be the husband I am, I wouldn't be the father I am. It was the hard times that really developed me. Those are the times that God really strengthened me. And that's what he promises to do in 1 Peter 5:10. In his kindness, God called you to share in his eternal glory by means of Christ Jesus. So after you have suffered a little while, he'll restore, support, and strengthen you. He'll place you on a firm foundation. The reality is we need God to put us in times of discomfort so he can work on us to develop us and grow us. And the experience in redemption is no different. You got to make some sacrifices from time to time. Jesus talked about this in Luke 9:23 when he says, if any of you wants to be my follower, you got to turn from your selfish ways, take up your cross daily, and follow me. You think about this. When Jesus says, take up your cross, Jesus didn't just die on the cross. What else did he do with the cross? He carried it for a long distance while he was being whipped and spit on, wearing a crown of thorns, having been stripped and beaten and bruised. He endured great suffering and great discomfort. Why? Because he knew it would be worth it at the end. And when we are going through difficult times, we just got to lean on the Lord and trust in the Lord that God's got you and he's going to make this redeemable and worth it when you get to the other side. Here's the third thing we need to understand. Moving from rejection to redemption also requires fulfilling our calling. In verse 6, it says, while they were still there, the time came for her baby to be born. Now, this is a special moment in the life of Mary and Joseph. This is the moment God has called them to. God called Mary to be the virgin that would give birth to the Son of God and the Savior of the world. Now, I can imagine there were lots of pressure on both sides of the family in this situation not to fulfill God's calling. Mary's family was probably saying, you know, you should think about giving this child up for adoption. You're really too young to be raising this baby on your own. You're not even married. It's going to be an embarrassment. Maybe we could just send you away. Just stay in Bethlehem until you have the baby. And then you can come back and nobody would ever know. You can just leave the baby over there for somebody else to raise. They didn't have this at the time, but if it was in today's time, they'd probably be pressured to have an abortion. You know, you can solve this problem. Make it all go away. You can just take care of this. That's a pressure people put on. Imagine Joseph's friends. I mean, come on, fellas. If you went to all your homeboys and you said, hey, man, I'm engaged to this girl. We haven't slept together yet, and she's pregnant. But it's cool because it's the Holy Ghost. What your friends going to tell you? I mean, come on, bro. Come on now. I'm telling you, she's messing around. Y'all not even married yet. You can get about this thing. I've officiated a lot of weddings. I officiated a wedding last night. Every wedding I've ever officiated, every single one of them, right before we walk out, one of the groomsmen looks at the groom and says, you know, it's not too late. It's like, nah, it is too late because I'm here and I ain't wasting my Saturday night because you changed your mind. You should have decided that 2 weeks ago, sucker. Look, even when people got a good situation, like, it's not too late. Imagine what Joseph's friends are telling him. We know how Joseph's family feels. They show up. She's knocked up. They not married. You ain't staying with us. We not having people know that's our family. You a distant cousin. You real distant. Like, we not even sure you in. That's how people treat the situation. I mean, imagine the pressure from Mary's family with the baby. Where'd they have the baby at? In Jesus' hometown. You know how in-laws are. Why you couldn't have a baby by us? We never got to hold the baby yet. Maybe for next Christmas, y'all bring the baby by our house. First Christmas, already splitting the family up. Right? So much pressure, but Joseph and Mary had to stand firm on what God was calling them to do. Mary and Joseph were willing to say, you know what, Lord, whatever you require of us, that's what we will do. We're willing to obey you and serve you and live for you. I mean, Mary and Joseph, they grasped the big picture. They realized that God was at work and this was bigger than just them. And that is a liberating moment in our lives when we get out of the place of selfishness and we realize what God's doing is way bigger than just our little lives and what we have going on. They got the big picture. They said, God, we're willing to follow you and serve you. 700 years before Jesus was born, the prophet Isaiah said in chapter 7, verse 14, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Look, the virgin will conceive a child. She'll give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel, which means God is with us. And that was Jesus. Jesus was God in human form, God being with us. This was God's calling, God's plan. Somebody had to be the virgin, and Mary was chosen to be it. It was a great honor before God. But in order to receive that honor, there were a lot of things that Joseph and Mary had to be willing to do without. I mean, you think about how much this messed up Mary's wedding plans. Right? God, that's not how I planned it. A lot of women have serious wedding plans. It's going to look like this. It's going to be like this. This is going to be the songs that we're going to do. They got the whole thing planned out. They don't even have a boyfriend. The man just fills in the empty slot. All I've been waiting on is you. I had the rest of it planned. It's going to be in October. I hope you don't mind. And the man's like, I don't care, whatever. That's how it goes down, right? Mary's wedding plans are all messed up now. Imagine Joseph. He's got to raise somebody else's kid down. That's not how he planned for it to go down. That's not how he planned for it to go. Everything is messed up. But it's not messed up at all. It's right where God wants it to be. When our lives seem the most messed up, that's often when we're right where God wants us to be. The problem is we're not looking for God. We're not leaning on God. We're not turning to God. People come to me and they say, man, you don't understand. My marriage is messed up. I'm like, no, you don't understand. You're right where God wants you to be. God's trying to get your attention. Maybe now you'll surrender and let things go. Maybe now you'll let God work. You don't understand. My finances are messed up. No, you're right where God wants you to be. Because God lets you mess things up sometimes just to remind you that you need him. Because when you got it all together, you don't need nobody. You don't need anybody involved in your life. That's why everybody in their life goes through a time where their life gets messed up from time to time. Now, some people are professionals at living messed up lives. That's not what we're talking about, okay? The reason God lets it get messed up is so you can do something about it. In John 14, verse 23, Jesus said, all who love me will do what I say. My Father will love them and will come and will make our home with each of them. What Jesus is saying is, look, you can either embrace the cards you're dealt, accept the lot you have, accept the marriage you're in and the children you have and the work situation and your financial condition, your spiritual place in life, what you've been set up for, the family of origin you have. You can receive that, accept it, and say, okay, God, I'm going to surrender it to you and let you work in it. Or you can try to continually push against it. Try to deny it. Try to push it aside. But God's telling you, look, receive what you have and understand. I see where you're at. I know what you're going through, and I want to do something about it if you'd let me. Here's the last thing. Moving from rejection to redemption also requires, number four, embracing our Savior. Embracing our Savior. In verse 7, it says, after Mary gave birth to her first child, a son, she wrapped him snugly in strips of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no lodging available for them. I told y'all I've had four kids. My wife's had four kids. I contributed in a small way. But here's the one thing I know. When people come to see you after you had a baby, what do they want to do? Hold the baby, right? Everybody wants to hold the baby, except for men with no children. They're scared to death. They think they're going to break the baby if they hold it. Everybody else wants to hold the baby. And I remember being scared. And then when Jack Hayden was born, my oldest son, he's 11 now. I could barely pick him up. But when he was born, I remember taking him in my arms, and I just felt like he just fits right here. He just fits so perfectly. And everybody would come, and they would say, can I hold the baby? And I almost didn't want to give him up. This one wants to hold him. That one wants to hold him. The children want to hold the baby. Everybody wants to hold the baby. And that's a great picture of how our relationship with God is supposed to be. We're supposed to embrace our relationship with God the same way Mary embraced the newborn Jesus. We're supposed to take our relationship with God in our arms and hold to it tightly and cling to it and embrace it and cherish it and let it become the most precious and important thing in our lives. That's the picture. Now think about this. If you don't embrace the Lord, what's the opposite of embracing? Rejecting. Now, you don't think you reject God because you're not consciously choosing to do so. But when you don't embrace something, you reject it. Say my wife comes to me and she says, baby, I planned a really nice special night for us. I've made dinner reservations. We're going to go out. We're going to have a good time. It's going to be me and you. And we're just going to spend time with one another. And I say, babe, I really appreciate you doing all that work. But I have to work late that night. I'm not going to be able to spend that night with you. Now, do I feel like I'm rejecting her? No, I don't. But does she feel like I'm rejecting her? Absolutely. See, we think if we're not embracing something, we can also not be rejecting it, but that's not the truth. The truth is you're either embracing it or you're rejecting it. And in the same way in our relationship with God, we oftentimes unwittingly and unknowingly reject Jesus. See, when we get rejected, it's the worst feeling in all the world. But we don't mind at all causing someone else to get rejected, especially God. I mean, think about it. God's already done all the work. He's already reached down from heaven. He's already given his life. He left the comforts of heaven to take the form of a man, to reach down from heaven, to embrace us. And in return, he says, will you embrace me back? And too often, we don't embrace him. We instead give him the stiff arm, the cold shoulder. We push him out. We don't make room for him. We cast him aside. We don't realize what we're doing, but we're really rejecting God from working in our lives. We don't consider it rejection because we just say, hey, I got other priorities. I'm too busy right now. I got this going on. I got that going on. But I mean, you think about it. We embrace the Lord when we choose to worship him, when we choose to live for him, when we choose to get in his word or attend church. We're embracing who God is in our lives. But too often we let other things get in the way, and then unknowingly and unwittingly we begin rejecting God. The thing about Jesus is that he's an expert at rejection. When you reject God, it's not the first time he's been rejected. I mean, you think about in this story we read, we realize that from the womb to the cross, Jesus was rejected. Jesus' rejection started with the fact there was no lodging for him and his parents. He had to be born in a feeding trough. That was his first crib, out in the stable where it was stinking and smelling like animals. There was no room for him in the family's house. He was rejected. It didn't stop there. The very next thing we read about Jesus is King Herod, the king at the time, tried to kill Jesus as an infant. He said, we're going to kill all the children, and hopefully one of them will be Jesus. The religious leaders of his day rejected Jesus' teaching. They eventually sought to have him killed. And we're even told in the Gospels, Jesus' own brothers rejected him. John 7, verse 5 says, for even Jesus' brothers didn't believe in him. The religious leaders rejected Jesus. As a result, one of his own disciples betrayed him, Judas, and another, Peter, denied him at the time when he needed his support the most. I mean, you think about that. Jesus' worst disciple and his best disciple both rejected him. Pontius Pilate rejected Jesus, even though he knew Jesus was innocent. And the people of Jerusalem rejected Jesus by saying, hey, why don't you free Barabbas, a lifetime criminal, and let Jesus go free? I mean, and let Jesus be crucified. And then if that wasn't enough, we find Jesus on the cross, where he's next to two thieves. And one of them rejects him. Says, I don't think you're the Son of God and the Savior of the world. And then at his very last moments when he's taking his last breath, he looks at God and he says, my God, why have you forsaken me? Jesus was rejected more than anyone. There's nobody who understands rejection like Jesus. And even today, a lot of us are sitting here rejecting Jesus from our own lives. God's asking us to do something. God wants us to do something. And we won't follow him. We won't surrender to him. We won't allow him to work in our lives. We give him the cold shoulder, the stiff arm, the Heisman Trophy. We push him out. We push him back. We don't make any room for him. We fill our lives with everything else. Sometimes it's work. Sometimes it's money. Sometimes it's sports. Sometimes it's the New Orleans Saints or the LSU Tigers until they start losing, and then we make room for somebody else. Sometimes it's food. Sometimes it's family. Sometimes it's all these things that compete for God's place in our lives, but we reject him. And we say, there's no more room for you. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to take a moment and just bow your head and close your eyes. And take a minute to reflect on your relationship with God. Many of you sit right where you're at. And you know in your life that something's missing. You know in your life that something's not what it needs to be. You might have even had some success from time to time. Things might be going well, everything might be going bad. But you just feel like, you know what, there's something missing. And the thing you're missing is your relationship with God. You haven't embraced it. You haven't held on to it. You've been rejecting God. God's trying to speak to you and you won't let him. God's trying to move in your life and you're pushing him back. God's trying to make room and you won't let it. You just keep filling it with something else. And no matter how much you try to fill it with, you just always feel like something's missing. And the only thing that's going to fill it is when you really surrender everything to God. When you embrace him like a mother embraces their own newborn child. When you take hold of him and you stop rejecting him. So the question is for you today. Are you willing to stop rejecting and start embracing? Because only then can God take the rejection in your own life and redeem it. So where you're at today, if you want to commit your heart and life to Jesus, and you want to surrender to him and embrace God, stop rejecting him. Here's what I want to challenge you to do. I want to challenge you to make a faith commitment, to pray a prayer, and to ask God to start something new in your life. A new embracing of who God is and what God wants for you. So where you're at right now, I just want to invite you to pray with me if you want to commit your heart and life to Jesus. To embrace God and to commit your life to him. You can just pray with me. Just pray something like this. Say, dear Lord Jesus, I admit that I'm a sinner. I admit that I've fallen short. I admit that I've rejected you. But I believe that you love me enough to come from heaven, to take the form of a man, to die on a cross, to pay the penalty for my sins, to forgive me, and to embrace me. I commit my life to you today, to live for you, and to serve you, and to be faithful to you. I want to be born anew. I want to come alive spiritually. I want to live a life embracing who you are and what you have for me. In the name of Lord Jesus, I pray. Amen. Look at me. If you prayed that prayer with me, and you meant it in your heart to commit your life to Jesus Christ, to serve Him and to live for Him, I want to challenge you today to check off on the back of the communication card you filled out earlier. Or if you haven't filled one out, you can still have time to do that. Say, I prayed with the pastor to commit my life to Jesus for the first time. I'd love to call you or to text you, to follow up with you, help you learn what it means to really walk with God. If you've taken that step but you've never gotten baptized, which is a public statement telling the world, I've died to myself and I've come alive in Jesus Christ. I've been forgiven and cleansed, and I know I'll be resurrected with God when it's time for my judgment. Never taken that step and you want to take that step, you can check that off. If you've taken those steps but you never become a member here at Celebration Church, you can check that off. If you got a prayer request or something we need to be praying for, you can check that off as well. Here's the reality. All of us need to decide in our lives, do we need to embrace what God is calling us to? I remember there was a woman named Penny Klein. She works at our church. And my first job at the church, I was a janitor. And I'd be vacuuming, and I'd walk by her, and I'd stop and talk to Miss Penny. And she'd always give me profound advice because she would always tell me what she was feeling in her own life. I remember one day, I said, hey, Miss Penny, what's going on? She said, man, God was just hitting me with it today. I said, oh, yeah, what's that? She said, well, I was praying and asking God, what did He want me to do? And He said back to me, I already told you what to do 5 years ago and you never did it. So why am I going to give you something new to do? Be faithful with what I've already said. I think there's some of you sitting in the room today, God's already told you what to do. God's already called you to do something, and you didn't embrace it when it was the time to embrace it. You didn't feel like you were rejecting it, but you didn't receive what it was. And the reason things have been stuck and the reason things have been going in a circle is because you haven't taken the moment to really surrender everything to God. Our life is all about embracing what God has for us. Even if it's uncomfortable, even if it requires endurance, even if it's not what we wanted, even if it's not what we planned for, we surrender it to God and we let Him work in it and we embrace what God has for us because we trust that God knows better than we know for ourselves. He's working behind the scenes. He's working ahead of schedule. He knows what's up.